Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Omar Aysa. I'm a security researcher by ERNW. And today's presentation will be about crashing Cisco's autonomic network. So what's the goal of today's presentation? Well, we will have a small introduction about what's autonomic network, how the components work together. We will have some, we will speak about a new assessment of the new technology, which is called autonomic network. And it's, for the first time, it's an assessment for a complete commercial implementation of the autonomic network. Cisco is one of the first companies to deploy autonomic network in their systems, and we will do today the assessment. So what do we expect from today's presentation? Well, we will have an understanding. We will speak about the architecture, how different components within autonomic network works. You'll understand how to deploy it in your system if you want. In the second part of the presentation, we will have something like, we will reverse engineer the proprietary protocol of Cisco. We will understand now how each and every bit, or the significance of each and every bit within the packets. And finally, we will disclose some vulnerabilities for the first time today. For today's agenda, it's mainly divided into three parts. The first part, as we spoke, it will be about autonomic architecture. We will have a theoretical understanding how Cisco implemented autonomic network, what does it mean, what's everything. In the second part, we will dive into the practical implementation. We will speak about the three phases of the autonomic protocol. And in the end, we will use such a knowledge of the protocol in order to understand and try to find vulnerabilities and exploit them. First, what's autonomic network, or what's this idea of autonomic principles or autonomic systems? Well, it has been IBM image since 2001 that they see that future systems, we need self-managing systems. When they said something like that, they meant that we need systems that doesn't need any human intervention. They are smart enough that they can configure themselves, that they can secure themselves. They are smart enough that they are aware of the processes running on their system, and they can optimize these processes, and even they can heal themselves, which means that they can recover from the broken processes. The people in Cisco and IETF, in the collaboration with IETF, started working on deploying this autonomic network and putting it into practice. And for anyone who would like to follow, you can just check the Anima group on the IETF. You will find there all the RFCs about what's autonomic networking and how it's deployed. Then one can ask, what are the main components for me to order to have an autonomic network? Well, it's easy. It's just one device we call the register. This register will be acting as the controlling point of the network, and it will be responsible to say whether some new nodes can join the domain or join your network or not. This is based on one list that we configure on it. Second, a CA certificate, or CA authority. Certificate authority here will act as an authority that will issue the certificates for a new enrollees. What does that mean? It's something like as if it's a proof that you are inside my domain. Once you join my network, okay, I will issue for you a certificate with your name on it. Hey, congrats, you are now part of the domain. And that's all. You don't need anything. Even with Cisco, your register or your device can act as both, can act as CA, can act as the register too. So literally, maybe all what you need is one device if you have a small network. If we'd like to understand how, have a macroscopic overview how the communication goes, the register is usually doing something like that. He's sending an update once it's configured saying, well, I'm searching, is there any autonomic device around? And once autonomic device hears, it asks, well, please, I would like to join your domain. The registers will ask, please generate a key so I can issue for you a certificate. Once that's done, the enrollee replies with the key, and after that, we start a secure channel. So everything in the autonomic network is totally secured, totally encrypted, totally authenticated. You just need some very few messages in the beginning in order to create such a channel. In order to see how it goes, we will have a small live demo for that. Okay, well, As you can see here, please, this is just a new device that I just bought. It's totally from the factory. I didn't put any configuration on. For people aware of Cisco, this is the first thing you see when you don't have any configuration at all. And all what I will do here is I'll just connect this device to the register and see how it will go. Well, I didn't configure anything. Supposedly there is no configuration at all here. Yeah, let's hope the demo works first. Okay. This is not good. Yeah. Here, the configuration starts. We will go into details what happens here exactly. But all what I would like to show to you that I didn't configure anything. I didn't put anything. I just bought it from the factory, get it from the factory, just connected to the register. And everything is being configured. Everything is automatically. You don't need to do anything. Everything is there. Even when we go into details, you will understand that you will get an IPv6 address like that. You will get all the information you need for your network to come up and work simultaneously, seamlessly, without any problems, without anything. So, what did we see from this demo for people? Well, for the thing which we call greenfield devices, the devices that we just bought, you don't need to configure anything. You just need to connect it to the register and it's configured. That's all. If your device have a configuration, it's not a big deal. You just go to the configuration mode and just try it autonomic. This is the simple and magic word that will make the system works. You don't need to configure anything more, and that's everything. So, well, this is the architecture of autonomic network or Cisco autonomic network. Well, it's a bit complicated. So Cisco explained it in 90 minutes. We will just go into the main components here to get some use cases, how it works, how's everything. What did I need to configure on my register to see what you have seen just from a few minutes ago? Well, all what I needed to configure is just 3 or 4 commands. I'll just go to the router and say, well, you will be an autonomic register and you will define a domain name. It's up to you, whatever you want. And you will say for the CA, you will either use the same machine, which means local, or you will just write the IP address of the external certificate authority if you have one, and that's it. After that, no shut, start enabling the autonomic register services and autonomic, start the autonomic services. And that's all. You don't need to configure anything. You don't need to add anything. Just 3-4 commands on your main device and any device that connects to it after that will come up instantaneously. Simple like this. So what happens after we write this 3-4 commands? If we are speaking about a local CA, first, the CA starts its functions. We generate a 3000 bit key, and after that, the CA starts to generate its root certificate. After that, the register becomes aware of something called its UDI. What's a UDI? It's a unique device identifier. Well, Cisco has thought that maybe we are speaking about new devices that doesn't have any configuration at all, how we can like just know which device is which. So they thought like to use a specific identifier, which is always unique. And what's that? It's just the serial number of the device. So what's an UDI? It's just a combination of the device model and device serial number. That's it. After that, the register starts generating its key too, and becomes aware of its domain ID, and also becomes aware of something called domain name, and also become aware of something called domain ID. What's a domain ID? It's just a number we give to the devices within our domain. How do you know it? It's just the interface MAC number dash your turn within the domain. So if you are the first one, it will be the interface MAC number dash 1. If you are the second, dash 2, dash 3, whatever it is. So it's just a number there. He will take all of this information, then pass it to the CA to issue a certificate, which we call the domain certificate. It's identification that now you are part of the domain. And what's that domain? The domain is here, it's called ERNW. So what's in the certificate? It's just your name, what's your domain name, what's your ID, and that's what's your public key. And that's what happens. Everyone that joins the domain has in his certificate this information. So once you see it, once you see even a neighbor for yours, you just check his domain name and you just make sure that it belongs to your domain. And that's it, you build the connection. What happens after that? Cisco thought in order to make the configuration as much independent as possible, once the register or the any device receives the certificate, it creates a VRF. For the people who are not aware of the concept of VRF, VRF is as if you are making a virtual router inside yours. You are making part of the router which is independent from the other configuration. So Cisco creates something like this, put all the information that it will receive now for the autonomic network within this VRF. And after that, it will create one loopback address, a one loopback interface, and assign it a specific address. According to this format, FD, which is for private IP, V6, and after that, like 40 bits from the SHA, first 40, SHA-1, first 40 bits of the domain name, then zeros, then the device ID that we set, like device MAC or the MAC address, and the ID. So all your devices without anything are configured like that automatically once they receive the certificate. So if this device now, which is new, has already an IPv6 running, has a VRF running on it, has everything. After we finish this, or after the register do such a stuff, it starts the phase one of the autonomic protocol, which they call the channel discovery. What do we do in this phase? The register is just sending a layer to probes saying, hey, I'm a register, I'm searching for any device which is working on autonomic network or capable of autonomic network. Once a client receives this, or once a client hears these probes and answers for that, we start the phase two of the autonomic protocol. We call it adjacency discovery. It's a UDP service, which runs on port 4936. What happens within this phase? There are mainly some few like levels or phases within this phase itself. Three packets sent in the beginning, the register saying, well, hey, I am supporting or I'm working or I'm the register for that domain. The in-relay replies with its UDI and the current domain. If the current domain is empty, it means, well, I would like to join yours. The register here checks something called the whitelist. So Cisco decided in order not to, for the register to accept all requests that they are being sent, we would just configure something called the whitelist on the register. And what's that? And just the list of the allowed UDIs, the list of the devices or the list of serial number of devices that are allowed to join our network. Once I get or grant permission for this, I will send my domain certificate. The in-relay will ask for a new domain certificate, will generate a key and pass it to me. And once I issue the certificate, we will start the last phase of the second phase, which we agree on the security parameters. Now we will build a secure and encrypted channel. What do you want to build it? How do you want to build it? For this, we have one of two options. Either one new technology developed by Cisco called DIEC, which is for data internet key exchange. It's the same idea of IPsec, but instead of having two phases, it's just the second phase of the data. Or use IPsec. For backward compatibility, they are using IPsec, but mainly now all devices prefer DIEC by default. Well, if you have been around Cisco for some time, you cannot even configure DIEC. There is no DIEC on the routers. There is no commands that you can write to configure or stop DIEC. This is how it's from theoretical point of view, all the phases. But let's see how this autonomic network is really following the autonomic concept we spoke about. Well, it's self-configuring because you don't need to configure anything. You just receive the certificate, you create a VRF, you take an IP address, all of that magically without configuring anything from your side. It's self-protecting because, ladies and gentlemen, the configuration of autonomic network is totally hidden. You cannot see it, you cannot edit it. it's totally inaccessible. You can just show, and you cannot do anything more. Everything is done. Cisco thought, like, we will do it on our own. We don't need you to configure anything, and you will not even be able to see anything with the configuration. Finally, the idea of self-healing is that they can recover. Because we have the certificates and we have the domain names, for any reason, if this connection broke up, then came up again, what will happen is that the register will check what's your domain name. And if your domain is mine, we have the same domain name, I'll check that your certificate is valid. And after that, we can have the process again. We can resend all the packets again. So it's totally automatic. For any reason, your router broke down, electricity went off, no problem. Once it comes back again, everything will be working seamlessly with no problems. So just to summarize this, or the theoretical implementation we spoke about, this is a quick summarization. How it will happen? The register starts first with something called channel discovery. I'm sending layer 2 probes. I'm sending layer 2 probes, asking whether there are any autonomic devices around. You just respond saying, yes, I'm here. Like that, we finished the layer 2 phase, or the channel discovery phase. We start the adjacency discovery phase, where I say to you, I support this domain. What's your domain name? And if your domain name is empty, it means you would like to join mine. I'll check the white access list if your serial number is there. And if it's there, I will ask you to please generate a certificate, or please generate a key. And once you give me the key, I will sign the certificate, create a certificate for you, and pass it back. And after that, we will have a secure, encrypted, authenticated channel where we speak. Okay. Well, this was for the theoretical implementation, or that's how Cisco implemented the autonomic protocol. Well, I got a little bit interested, and I wanted to see how it would look like on the Wireshark. Well, initially, I expected that I will find at least three phases. I find, like, we spoke layer 2, and after some time, UDP packets on port 4936, and finally, something like either IPsec or Dyke. But that's what I found. Totally nothing. Totally nothing. It's for LLC, it's a layer 2 technology. And once you try to see this on the Wireshark, you won't get anything from what Cisco said. So Wireshark couldn't analyze or understand what are the packets being sent between the devices. So I tried to use one reverse engineering tool, at least I tried to understand the protocol. I used NetZop. But NetZop, the one I was working on, supports only IPv4, and this is an IPv6 technology, so it didn't work. As a result, I thought that I will do it manually. Well, this is the first frame being sent by the register, and now the question is, how do we start? Before we start in this, we will go a very brief introduction. What are the different types of protocols? Well, network protocols can be either text-based, something like HTTP, where you see the words, you see the strings, it has a meaning, or it's binary-based, you don't understand anything. You just look, see, don't get any idea what does these numbers mean. Even the binary has one of two types, either fixed, something like that. Does anyone know what that header can be? Well, this is a UDP header. Everyone see it every day, but this is the idea. It's fixed. You will never understand what those mean, except if you know how they formatted it, how the header looks like. And once you know the header, you can understand it. The other type is called variable length, or TLVs. The idea of TLVs is that the protocol is divided into chunks. We are not speaking about fixed boundaries. No, we are speaking about chunks. How do you know the length of the chunks and how do you know everything? It's mentioned in the protocol. So here you see something called type, which is here type 4, for example, and here the length is 8. And when you count the numbers, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this is how you understand this protocol. Well, returning back to our protocol, what is it? Is it text-based, binary-based? Is it fixed? Is it variable? Is it fixed and variable? What's that?
Binary and
No, no, no. There is binary, but can be binary text. We can say because it has some text, it's not pure text, but it's binary. And it's binary TLV. So our protocol is fixed with some TLV port. It has both. How do we start? First thing that usually we find in our frame is the Ethernet frame. There are three types of the Ethernet frame, and the one in our protocol is the last one, which is the snap one. So time to start analyzing the protocol. Destination MAC address, source MAC address, frame length, and after that the snap frame identifier, and after that organization unique identifier. This is for Cisco. And after that, this is the AN protocol ID. This is what Cisco has chosen to be the protocol ID for the autonomous network. Starting from this phase, we will start in the channel discovery information. Well, I believe it can be analyzed based on this header. This is best effort work. I did it with the help of a friend of mine called Mark Heusel, the inventor of the Hydra tool and the hacker guide or the hacker choice. But mainly, I believe it can be analyzed based on this information. To see how it goes, we will see it like that. The first two bits, or the first byte is, first one is the version of the protocol, which is here one, and the we have zero. For the states, it's just something that say which state are we in now in the protocol, and for the channel discovery, it's always O1. We have some factory default, this bits or this bytes never change. They are always the same. And after that, we start with the operation code. What's an operation code? It means what type of this packet is. What does it mean? For the channel discovery, we have some operation codes. O1 is usually when you say, like, this is the announcement, this is the reply for the announcement, and this is the acknowledgement, and some keep alive. After that, we have the header length here. And we have some reserved bits here. And after that, we start with the idea of type length and value. What are the available types for the channel discovery? They are here. Those are the ones. Like that, these are all the frames that you would see in the channel discovery. That's how you can look on the back packets and understand what does they mean. We will go to the second phase. The adjacency discovery. Well, the packet now looks a little bit bigger. We will start with the same concept. Here it will be the Ethernet frame for us. Here will be a customized channel discovery header. They added such a header. But can anyone realize the difference between this header and the one we had before? For example, with respect to the state? Well, the differences are here. State here are always O5, which means this is not a channel discovery header. There is an adjacency discovery header coming after that. And the length is always fixed, 14. And in the end, there is an ether type, which is saying there is an IPv6 header coming after me. So here's the IPv6 header. And after that, there is the UDP header. And finally, we start again with the same header that I believe we can use to also understand the adjacency discovery information. The version here is 2, and one reserved bit 0, same idea, and the state here is 02. Because here we have three different states, when we said like domain announcement, and when we said about certificates and everything, we have here three states. One sent in the beginning where you say like, I'm that domain name, and the second one is about bootstrapping, where you get the certificates and everything. And the last phase is negotiating secure parameters, when you say what will be the secure parameters of the coming state. After that, it's some reserved bits. And we start with the operation code also for the AD. Well, for the operation codes, here are they. What it means, what does this packet do? What's the function of this packet? What's the significance of this packet? Here are the different types. Well, this is based on best effort work. I didn't confirm this with Cisco, but this is our analysis. And after that, we go to the header length, some default bits or bytes that never change, and we start with the type length and value again. Well, they are quite big. If I added the types here, it would be something like 4 or 5 slides. So if people are interested in seeing all the types, I have added a blog post on Insinuator, which have all the types, which have all of this. And after that, finally, we reach the secure channel phase. Okay, one of my wishes was to see what are the packets being sent inside the tunnel. And I wanted to know what are they sending, what are the information sent. So does anyone have any idea how can I get such an information? How? Okay. Please let me introduce to you the ME3600X. I start thinking why there is an IPsec and dike. And my main idea was maybe dike is used for the newer systems and IPsec is for the backward compatibility. The ME is one of the first devices that supports AN. AN started deployment of the AN started at 2014 from Cisco. And this is one of the first devices. I thought maybe if I got like an old image, I won't find dike there, I only find an IPsec. Okay, but even if I found IPsec, can we break IPsec? No, but there is IPsec null. I can configure here and there, and I can see what's there. Well, this is one of the most difficult packets to get. This is from inside the tunnel. Here is it, the GRE tunnel. And this is called RPL, and RPL is the routing protocol for the autonomic network. After we analyzed and understood how the protocols, or how the protocol is constructed, what's the significance of each and every packet, what about using such information to take the network down? Or in other words, to make a correct security assessment for the network. I already know that we have the whitelist, and what will be the task of the malicious user? Well, he will always try either to get access into the network, either to bypass this white access list, or just hinder the performance. I kept thinking, what's the function that the register used, for example, to search within his whitelist? If I took, for example, like a simple thought, like grep in the Unix systems, and I sent something like space or null here, what would be the result? The result would be the whole list. What if I send a null or a space to the register and see how it will respond? Here, I'm on the register. And here. As usual, let's hope it works. Well, what I'm trying to do here, I'm trying to simulate as if I'm new in relay that's trying to connect to the register, and we'll try to, for example, to send some packets. Okay, this is that. Am I connected to the register? I'm not connected. This always happens to me. Thank you. Let's see, no. Am I up? I'm trying here to say as if I'm space. Here, near UDI is space. There is nothing. Okay. Don't worry, people. I got a video too for you. Well, I'll try to send it again to see what's wrong. Well, it didn't work as expected. This is bad. One sec. Do you want to see the video or you want to see the real one? See, where's the problem? Okay. This is bad. I didn't expect that to happen. I can show you a video for that. Did I figure out? Usually, this is what happens when you send. It's exactly the same. Everything. This is usually what happens. Suppose it's exactly the same script as yesterday. I didn't change a word. Okay. Sorry. I don't think, honestly, because usually it's the same everything. I didn't change, but maybe something happened that... Yeah, I understand your point. I can exit from here, but I don't think it's the main problem. Sometimes it hangs, it doesn't work as expected. Don't know why. Although it's just public, unconfirmed. I think maybe it's something with the offload. No, it even doesn't detect it. Okay. Just happens. Yeah. We will maybe do it in the end of the presentation. I promise you it will break out. But at least on social media. Yeah. It happens. Sometimes. Okay. Well, the truth is the register cannot handle neither null nor space at the UDI. And this has been confirmed with Cisco. It's with this CVE. It will be published today within like 2-3 hours. And if you would like to know how it's from Cisco side, this is what Cisco has assigned to this bug. It can neither understand null nor space. Well, what's here? Okay. For the adjacency discovery, I thought, what if I made some like crafted packets? I put some unexpected types within this packet. There is something wrong. I put some unexpected types within this packet and assigned unexpected values. Well, this is the second demo and it will work. So let's see. This is the register again. And here is it. Finally, something works. Well, I won't be able to disclose the what's this in or what's being sent exactly, because as you will see in few minutes, this bug is more than what you expect. It has another dimension. It has a bigger problem than what you can see. But here, if you send a specifically crafted packet, it can take the register down. So what are the problem? The ISR 4321 will be crashed if it's running autonomic services and it received one crafted packets. The details of this bug or this attack will be soon on Insinuator. Why we are not saying about the details now and everything? Because of this. This bug is not just for autonomic services. It's totally for every IPv6 on the ISR. So what I will try to do now, I will disable autonomic services. I will shut it down and I'll just have an IPv6 address and I will send the same information again. Register is still down, so we'll go to the client. This is the client that just came up. We will just give it an IPv6 address. Okay, that's all. Here is it. Nice. So just by knowing the IPv6 address, you can crash the ISR down. You can take the Denali IOSs down. The new Denali, which are the IOSs 16.2 and 16.3, the new ones, both are vulnerable to such an attack. It's a global attack. You don't need to be on link local. Just by knowing your IPv6 address, the router can be took down.
Is this just ISR 16 releases?
As far as I know, there are two IOSs, like Denali 16.2 and 16.3. I didn't try it on other stuff, but today also, Cisco will be launching the vulnerability or the advisory where they will include everything about this vulnerability. Please, if you have such a device or such an operating system, make sure to update it to the newer one. Finally, in today's presentation, we have spoken about autonomic network, we went into the three phases of the AN protocol, we reverse engineer, and we understood the significance of each and every bit. And we find two vulnerabilities that the register cannot handle, neither null nor space, and those system, the denial 16.2 and 16.3 are vulnerable. So please upgrade if you have them. Final thing, stay tuned. There will be more vulnerabilities. I'm now in discussion with Cisco for three other more vulnerabilities. So stay tuned. Everything will be there, published on Insinuator. So keep it up, keep looking. Just once we get the, once we finish the disclosure procedures, we will disclose them. I have provided three posts about autonomic networking, the one like we did in this presentation, about like the introduction and the analysis, the full analysis that we have seen with the, all the types and everything. And today we will write about the vulnerabilities. And finally, I would like to thank Mark Hoyza for helping me with the analysis of the protocol. Thank you for your time, and I hope you enjoy the presentation. So, time for questions.
I'd like to comment that the technology itself is a really cool technology. It's not, I feel a bit bad about like showing it, and especially given the people here in the room who were involved with creating this and others who run this. It's not about like bashing the stuff. It's from a design, from what it does. I think it's really cool stuff. There was a presentation at RIPE, I think it was Amsterdam, must be like 70 or 71, where this was shown. And I was sitting in a room, and I even tweeted about this. This is great, great stuff. This is really cool if it holds the promises. And when we looked at, started looking at it, all this makes sense. It's just there are some subtle checks that might miss in certain packets.
Yes, sure.
Okay, first of all, thanks for the great talk and for your work. And my question actually is regarding the upcoming vulnerabilities. Did you by any chance manage to circumvent the whitelist? Because from an attacker's point of view, it would be great to attach yourself to any given corporate network on demand.
I won't say that I managed to do that, but what I can say to you that I managed to see what's there inside the secure channel. So I don't need to get inside your network, I just know what you are sending. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay, thanks. Have a great day today.